Thank you, guys. And I really want to thank Kaylin Higgins and Peter and Fred and Nancy Bass for letting us do this amazing rare books room. And I always start by saying it's so hard for independent bookstores, so buy books. Make sure you buy books here. And I tell my students, you're not allowed to buy books from Amazon or online or any place where you can't do a reading, because otherwise there won't be any more bookstores to do book events and readings. And they have, aside from unbelievable books here, I spend more here than I've spent in the rare books room on like shoes and clothes and food, but they also have fantastic notebooks and pens and all kinds of cool stuff downstairs also. So thank you guys so much for letting us use the rare book room for tonight. And the way tonight started was that I know Rob Spillman for many years as the founder and editor of Tin House, which is this wonderful literary magazine. And he's not only spoken to my classes and my panels, but he's let me and tons of my students break into Tin House and tinhouse.com. And actually, they did a great piece on my last book. And it's just this really beautiful, important literary magazine. And Rob is sort of famous for launching tons of people's careers. And it took him 10 years to finish his own debut memoir, All Tomorrow's Parties, just this amazing book about growing up in Berlin and finding out that as a little kid, his father was gay and his parents were both classical musicians, and they got divorced, and he goes back at the fall of Berlin with his wife to sort of retrace his steps. So anyway, it's this beautiful memoir, and I said to him, how could we, you know, he was doing a lot of book events, how could we do something special to celebrate? And he and I came together, thought, let's get together some of our favorite colleagues and our most brilliant editors and agents to not only celebrate his book, but also to do what he has done best for so many years and what I like to do as a teacher, which is to inspire other people to finish their projects, their dream projects that they've been doing. Anyway, so we have this amazing, astounding audience and panel, and what we're going to do is I'm going to ask questions. I'll introduce everyone, ask questions, and then we're going to open it up for questions for you. And at the end, we're going to sign books for you if you want, and you can come meet everybody quickly. So all the way down at the end, because I did it in alphabetical order, is Corrina Barsan, who is Rob's editor, who published All Tomorrow's Parties. And Corrina was born in Queens, and she's a senior editor at Grove Atlantic. She started her publishing career at Farrar, Straus, Giroux before joining the independent publishing house Other Press. And she's edited literary fiction and nonfiction from around the world, including books by Jan Lanke, Peter, Nathaniel Maley, Michelle Hoover, Leslie Maitland, Jose Manuel Prieto, and Bonnie Nasdem. And she teaches at Columbia University of the Arts. And right next to her is Jill Bialosky, and she was born in Cleveland, Ohio, and she studied for her undergraduate degree at Ohio University and received a Master's of Arts degree at Johns Hopkins University and a Master's of Fine Arts from the University of Iowa's Writers Workshop. She is the author of 4 volumes of poetry, 3 novels, and the New York Times best-selling memoir, History of a Suicide, My Sister's Unfinished Life, and her most recent award-winning book is The Prize, which we have here tonight, and she is an editor at Norton. Okay, and next to her is David Daley, and I know David because he was the editor-in-chief of Salon, and again, he came to speak to my classes, and he let so many of my students break in and publish fantastic essays and book reviews and Q&As and just fantastic pieces for Salon. And he recently left Salon to become the editor, the publisher of The Mirror in Connecticut, where he's from. And again, Dave helps a lot of other people, but he just recently was able to launch his own debut book just in time for the elections, Ratf, The True Story Behind the Secret Plan to Steal America's Democracy. And it just came out from Live Right. And congratulations on Raves in the New York Times and a huge piece on The New Yorker. So we're so excited that he's joining us. And right next to him is Aspen Matis. And Aspen was a student of mine. She was a 21-year-old undergraduate, and she started writing beautiful essays that actually some of them appeared in Salon and in Tin House. And she launched a fantastic book, Girl in the Woods, which was a really brave memoir about how she was raped her second day of college and dropped out of school to walk the 2,500-mile Pacific Trail, and wrote a gorgeous book about it, and she's now a spokesperson for RAIN. And the book just came out in paperback, and she sold TV film rights, and she has this very cool young producer who threw us this amazing party. It's the hippest I've ever been, with all these 25 and 30-year-olds in Venice, at a mansion in Venice, in California. So now you know why I help you guys, my students, publish, because I need to be cooler and hipper, and we're so glad she could join us. And next to her is Ayesha PandeDebut, who has worked in the publishing industry for 20 years. Before becoming a literary agent, she was a senior editor at Farrar, Straus, and Giroux. She also held editorial positions at HarperCollins and Crown Publisher. She was a member of AAR, PEN, the Asian America's Writers Workshop, and sits on the advisory board of the German Book Office. She was born in India, and she, her agency, which is located in Harlem, publishes literary fiction and nonfiction, and we're so excited she could join us. And next to her is one of my favorite people in the world, Danielle Perez, who was also born in Queens. And Danielle was the editor who gave me my first chance at books 13 years ago when she was at an editor at Random House, and she published three of my memoirs, and now she'll never get rid of me for her whole life, especially when I do panels. And most recently, she has switched to Berkeley Penguin, and she does both fiction and nonfiction, and I'm so excited she could join us. And next to me is the man of the hour, Rob Spillman, who, as I said, is the author of All Tomorrow's Parties, and 18 years ago, he... he was born in Berlin, which actually you'll know when you read the memoir. And he launched Tin House 18 years ago. And he was recently awarded the Penn Nora Magid Award for editing. His writing has appeared in Book Forum, GQ, Guernica, New York Times, Book Review, Rolling Stone, Sports Illustrated, Vanity Fair, and Vogue. He's currently teaching at Columbia University writing program. And so what I do is I thought I would start, just jump in and start asking questions. And like I said, then you guys can ask your own questions too. So let me start with Corrina. So Corrina, a lot of my students, undergrad, graduate, are asking, you know, we just finished summer class, summer term, and a lot of people graduated, and a lot of them are asking, like, what do I do? How do I get into publishing? How do I become an agent? Do I need a graduate degree? So maybe you could start by telling us, so what did you do right out of school, and did you always know that you wanted to be an editor?
I had a kind of untraditional route into publishing. I was a photo editor for a number of years. I worked in magazines and worked on illustrated books. So I didn't do the traditional route, which many people coming out of college will. Internship is the biggest way. They'll intern for a couple of publishing houses, a couple of agencies, get a good feel of the market and which editors are out there, which agents, and just a feel for how it all works is the most valuable thing. But there are also publishing courses that you can take. There's a Columbia publishing course, and it's a summer program where you can kind of have a mock publishing house and see how a publishing house operates and go through all of the motions of publishing a book and setting up an actual house and what they would do. So that's another thing to do. You can do both. Or you just kind of apply and hope you get in, which is
Is that what you did? Yeah, tell us a little bit. How did you get to Grove?
Well, it was, I was applying any which way that I could through, I think it was Galley Cat had postings, and there were other ones, and every big corporate house has listings, and you know, it goes to HR, and no one, you feel like no one's looking at them. But I think I got an interview at Oxford University Press, and I didn't get that job, but I got passed on to another editor, and then to another editor, and ended up at FSG, where I was working with John Glossman. So it was luck, but it was also a lot of hustle too, and you kind of have to figure out which publishing house you would want to work in, and what's the right match. So you have to do your homework somewhat to see who publishes what kinds of books and where you're a good fit. So they're different routes.
Great. And Jill, there's a lot of people on the panel who, like me, love writing and want to be a writer, but also do something else to pay the bills. Like, I'm a teacher, and my husband also does TV film, and he teaches. And so with you, you started with poetry, right?
As a writer?
Yes.
Yes.
So at what point did you realize that you would, you know, that maybe editing on a full-time basis would be a good thing to combine with your own writing?
Well, I've been an editor at Norton now for over 25 years, which is very hard to believe. And I actually never imagined that I would become an editor. I graduated from the Iowa Writing Workshop, and I decided to move to New York and to try to get a job, and publishing seemed like an interesting one because I had worked at a couple literary magazines when I was an undergraduate. I worked at Ohio University, the Ohio Review, which was a very prominent literary magazine. And I really was just looking for a job to help support me as a writer, and I was at that time, one would apply for jobs from the newspaper, and I found my first job at Oxford University Press from an ad in the newspaper, and I worked for a religion and philosophy editor for about 6 months, and then I heard about this job at Norton, which was a perfect fit for me because I was a young poet, and you know, Norton, I knew all about Norton from the Norton Anthologies of Literature that I studied in college, and we published Adrienne Rich, who was a huge hero of mine as a poet. And so, a long story, but you know, this, it sort of evolved, and I didn't realize that I would really love being an editor. But as I became immersed in the job, I was just fascinated by watching how these manuscripts would come over the transom, and you know, we would discover somebody we wanted to publish or a book we wanted to publish, and then you know, a year later, there's this incredible book. And so I was just fascinated by the process. And then it's just been a juggling act to both, you know, have a full-time job as an editor, and I edit literary fiction, and I edit our poetry list at Norton, and also a lot of nonfiction. So it's a real full-time job, but it's a great balancing act for me.
Great, and Dave, I think you've told my classes that you've had like 20 different jobs in publishing, right? So, and I, by the way, and everybody loves to hear that, because my students hate it if there's somebody that just, you know, graduates and gets an internship and a great job and stays there and is happy. They love 20 years of misery before you find yourself, everybody could identify. So tell us some of the places you worked, if you don't mind.
Sure.
And actually, you don't have a journalism degree, do you?
I do.
Oh, you have a journalism degree from North Carolina.
Yes, I graduated into the first George Bush recession, so I went and hid out in graduate school for a couple of years after that and came out with a journalism degree. Really, graduate school for me was just a chance to freelance, and what I did for years and years was just try to write about everything I loved for anybody who would have me, whether it was culture, whether it was news, whether it was politics, and you just keep going. I mean, We're sitting here in New York's East Village. We're blocks away from sort of every great scene that has been launched out of this city. You don't need anybody's permission to do any of this. If you want to start your own thing, go start your own thing. I think that there are, if you want to write about music or write about politics, you don't need anybody's permission these days to go ahead and do it. And I think the lesson right now is that there are lots and lots of big places that are looking for the people who are out doing it. I mean, just go look and see how many N plus one editors have book deals. It is, if you get out and do your thing and start your scene and follow what it is that you love, other people respond to it, they find it, they see it, it works out.
Great, and actually, perfect intro to Aspen. So Aspen, you were taking writing classes, and I remember you started with essays, and do you think if somebody has a book project that an essay might be a good idea to start?
Yeah, absolutely. Like when I signed up for your class, I had no idea that I even had permission to submit to the New York Times, and she was like, you know, shoot for the top, like you can't get in if you don't submit. And I was just absolutely baffled by how receptive the editors who came to our class were. And actually, Rob was one of those editors. And Yeah,
you were actually smart because
no hierarchy.
Do you admit how many times you rewrote your first piece that you sold, though? Because I always say to my students that, like, it's not a great idea to write something really quick and at 3 a.m. without showing it to anyone, send it to the New Yorker.
Right.
So Aspen, you actually had a good attitude. So
yes.
How many times did you rewrite, would you say?
19.
For the first piece?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And you still rewrite a lot, right?
I do, yeah. And I remember in the very beginning of the class, I kind of felt like Sue would line edit everyone's work, and I felt like she was right about everyone else, but I was the exception. And
oh yeah, you had line breaks for your essay, because she liked poetry.
It was my modern love was a poem. Which the New York Times
I said it's beautiful. It's beautiful, but she wanted to be in the specific New York Times Modern Love column, so I kept taking out the line breaks and the semicolons.
Yeah.
Yeah, only one. You're only allowed one semicolon in the piece, not 14. Anyway, Ayesha, so could you tell us a little bit about how you got started and, how did you become a literary agent?
I had a very circuitous route. I was an editor for 15 years, starting out with a very small German fine art publishing house. And from there, I went to Reader's Digest, and I condensed books for 5 years. And I landed in trade publishing via Crown. And then after that, I was HarperCollins. And my last job as an editor was at Farrar Straus. I launched my agency a little over 10 years ago. And I actually see one of our wonderful interns in the room. whom we would not be able to do without. So I just want to applaud all of the interns who give us so much of their time and their energy and their resources. It's very special.
And since we have a great agent here and so many of my students want to publish books, if you don't mind, maybe I'll ask you a few specifics. Usually with my students, when we talk about it, if somebody wants to do a poetry collection, short stories, a novel, they have to pretty much write the whole book. Whereas if somebody wants to do nonfiction, they can do a proposal. And is that, before somebody even considers approaching an agent, they should pretty much either have a completed proposal or a complete manuscript of short stories, poetry, or a novel? Is that how you prefer before people come to you?
If they're debut authors, yes. If they, but there might be very compelling reasons for me to, you know, consider taking them on a partial, which is if they've had a lot of other kinds of success, such as having had, stories published in high-profile magazines and things like that.
Fantastic. And a lot of agents say they have a website that lets people know what genres they do. So if somebody wanted to contact you, they should probably first go to your website and make sure that they know what you're interested in. Right.
Yeah, it's really important for me to know why I'm being queried. So it's a good idea to check the submission guidelines very closely.
Great. And if you don't mind, one more question, which is that I think a lot of people make the mistake, especially because it's so easy to email, that they'll just like email a complete manuscript to an agent without even figuring out whether that agent does science fiction or whether that agent does YA. So do you, on your website, do you explain how you would want somebody to approach you? Because I know some agents would prefer a short letter and maybe just, the first 5 pages of a book, or you're explicit about that in the website?
Yeah, I'm very explicit about that, and our interns, look through the initial queries, and if they don't follow the guidelines, they're very frequently not even passed along.
Good, good. And Danielle, could you talk a little bit about how you became an editor first at Random House, and now at Penguin, which is the same company now, right?
Yeah, I actually started at Penguin initially, but I went to college in the Twin Cities in Minnesota, and I had an internship there at Milkweed in Minneapolis, which was a literary great press. And then I came back to New York, because I'm from New York, and got a job at Dutton, which is part of Penguin, and I just as an editorial assistant, and my only experience was having been an intern, which I thought it was good experience at the time, and now that I hire assistants, I think internships are just crucial, even more than publishing programs personally to me, having experience in a publisher, having worked with an agency or an agent, I think is really key to understanding how the whole process works. And so I was there for a few years, and then I moved over to Delacorte and Bantam, and 6 years ago I moved over to Berkeley, which is a division of Penguin. So I've worked at a number of Random House and a number of Penguin divisions over the last years.
And I'm pretty sure that with Penguin and Random House at this point, most editors say that they would prefer to be approached by an agent. So are you at a point where you would prefer that if somebody meets you at the panel and says they're great, that they should probably, if they have a book project, they should probably first get an agent and then say to the agent, oh, I met Danielle at a panel.
Yeah, we pretty much only accept things through agents because we just get so many even projects from agents over, you know, that are emailed and sent and discussed with editors. But yeah, that's always a good, if you've made a contact with an editor and, you know, you have an agent or you're getting an agent, to say that X editor might be interested in your work because you've met them.
Great. And Rob, you have a great background in terms of, you did a lot of cool stuff before you became an editor at Tin House. So tell us a little bit about, and you didn't study writing, I remember, right?
No. I have an undergraduate degree in psychology, and I went to grad school for sports psychology and exercise physiology. And I dropped out of that program at the University of Arizona, moved here with $150 and no connections and no idea how publishing works. But I worked in a used bookstore when I was an undergrad in Baltimore. So I had sort of visions of working in publishing. So I first worked in a art postcard factory for a year. And then I got an entry-level job at Random House in publicity. And I was there long enough to figure out that I was really crappy at publicity. But it got my foot in the door, and I was... From there, I was able to figure out sort of how publishing worked, and I started writing book reviews for anybody who would let me write a book review. And no one ever asked me where I went to school, they just asked to see my clips. You know, what Dave said is, like, people only care about your work. You could come from, you know, you could be living in a cave for 50 years, and no one will care if you have the writing chops. And you are also pleasant to work with. I got a lot of work just by being in the right place at the right time, and by turning in clean copy, not being difficult. I can't stress that enough. I know it sounds ridiculous, but the business is predicated on relationships, and you get a lot of work by recommendations. And, you know, if you are decent to work with, you know, you turn in a copy to an editor and say, oh, my partner works over at X, they're looking for Y. You know, just things like that happen. And so I started writing for bigger and bigger places. And again, I'm just going to cop everything that Dave says. But, you know, I wrote about what I loved, what I was passionate about, and trying to figure out how to get it into the biggest places I could. So not just, you know, sort of preaching to the converted. So I had to figure out how... my needs and the needs of the magazines aligned. So, for example, I wrote a piece about Leonard Peltier for Vogue magazine, and he's American Indian activist who's been in prison since 75. And so not a natural fit for Vogue, but Vogue has a circulation of 4 million. The way I got it in was Robert Redford financed a documentary about Peltier. So I went to Vogue and said, Robert Redford, comma, Leonard Peltier. And they didn't even hear Leonard Peltier. They sent a crew to Idaho, shot Redford at his ranch, and I wrote 2,000 words about Leonard Peltier. So, but I mainly wrote book reviews, did a lot of interviews, and when the old Details magazine, I wrote a lot for them, and when they decided to start a book column, I was in the right place at the right time, and I wrote the book column there for 5 years, And at the end of that 5 years, I started Tin House. That's the super condensed version of it. It's not linear. There are many ups and downs. There was a missing year in there or two, you know, things like that.
Great. And do you want to talk about some things that you might be open for at Tin House? There's Tin House, which comes out, like four times a year, mm-hmm. beautiful hardcover paperback literary magazine. And then there's the Tin House Online. Mm-hmm. So if somebody was interested, I know that you've done poetry, fiction, excerpts from books, essays. They do a great column called Lost and Found, where somebody writes a first-person essay about a book that maybe didn't get its due that was really important to them, that Aspen and I both did that column. And online, it seems like you do shorter pieces like flash fiction.
Mm-hmm. Flash fiction. We do a lot of interviews. What you are trying to do when you're trying to break in is get in by any means necessary and get the ear of editors. And so I used to work at the New Yorker, I left that out. But people would send the New Yorker these, you know, 10,000, 20,000 word pieces, and they would be great. And you'd look at them and you'd go, wow, this is great. It's you or Joan Didion who's under contract. You know, good luck. But, you know, they're always looking for talk of the town pieces, which are 800 word, you know, and a great way to sneak into the New Yorker. Like all magazine, find a way into the magazine. And for us, it's like Lost and Found, or the website is a great way in. And then you sort of, you circumvent the slush pile. And this, because the slush pile, I get about 20,000 submissions a year, you know. So, you know, I'm very open to new writers, but you just have to get in. And I want to echo the thing about interns. In the 18 years that I've been running Tin House, I've never hired from the outside. Everybody who's ever worked for me started as an intern and worked their way up to an editorial assistant. It's just you've proven yourself, you know the system, you know who we are, you can put up with us, and you know our foibles. And so, you know, and if I can't get you a job as an intern, I will recommend you to other places, you know.
No, my students still quote you. So they said, what's the most important thing to remember when you start submitting your work to editors and agents? He said, don't be crazy. So write that down. Corrina, now at Grove Atlantic, is it the same as Danielle said at Penguin that you need a literary agent? Or can people ever approach editors there with projects, book projects?
Yeah, it's the same method. It's just, you know, the sheer quantity of submissions that you're getting, we just can't fully give what attention we would want to submissions that would come in cold. So,
and could you talk about what kind of books you would be open for at Grove Atlantic? You do, I know Grove Atlantic
do, yeah.
does fiction and nonfiction, right?
Yeah, we do both. It's mainly literary fiction, works in translation, a broad stretch of nonfiction. So it's general, but there's just a legacy of just having literary fiction, and there's a small list of psychological thrillers, domestic thrillers, but they're more on the higher end and not that commercial.
And do you agree that before somebody even goes to an agent, or when an agent comes to you, that pretty much if it's a debut novel that they should pretty much write the whole book, but that if it's nonfiction, sometimes, like I know I think Rob sold his book on a proposal. No, you wrote the whole book? Oh, you wrote the whole book. So you will consider a proposal for nonfiction, but for a debut novel you have to pretty much have the whole thing, don't you?
Yeah, it's more beneficial to have the whole thing because it's hard to know where the novel's going and how the book comes together. I would say that for memoir, that's kind of the general rule as well. I mean, sometimes we'll see proposals for memoir, but it's kind of the same feel that you need to get a sense of the overall picture and the arc of the story. Often memoirs have that novelistic style. So it's helpful to have it all, it's not always that you need the whole thing. There are times where, like, let's say I bought a story collection and I bought the novel as well on partial. So there are different scenarios, but it really all depends. I think your best odds are with the full manuscript.
Great. And Jill, I always say to my students, I have an MFA in poetry, and whenever they ask me about poetry or poetry book or short stories, I always say your best bet is to start publishing. And I know, you know, and if you could get good publications, that would help. And I know that it says your poems and essays have appeared in The New Yorker, O Magazine, Paris Review, The Nation, New Republic, Kenyon Review, American Poetry Review. So you've done that. So would you say for somebody starting out, either writing short stories or a essay collection or poetry that's starting to get published in some place like Tin House is a great way to start?
Oh, yes, definitely. I mean, I think that the process for a poet is very similar to the way in which Dave also described being a journalist or a freelance writer, is that you want to try to get your poems out there and develop an audience so that when you do have a book, then there's some familiarity with your name and that you've been published. And it's very hard as an editor of poetry, for instance, to publish a poet who has not had publications in many literary magazines and is not really a part of the literary community, because the books are so difficult to get readerships for. And one of the ways that we depend on getting the readership is that, you know, and this goes for novelists and short story writers and memoirists as well, is really working very hard to develop a readership. And nowadays there's such an opportunity to do that with so many online publications and literary blogs, and you know, I think it would be very unusual to take on a writer that had not been published in any place anymore. I mean, certainly it can happen, but I think that it's very important to do that. Also, it helps a writer develop confidence, which is, as we all know, very important in the process.
Great. There's some more chairs back here. I see some people standing. Could we help get them chairs over here? There's a whole stack of them, so you guys could be comfortable. And actually, that's a perfect lead-in to Dave, because you have let so many of my students publish fantastic pieces in Salon, and they've gone on to do books. In fact, Aspen and several of my students, I think, launched books in Salon. So now I know the easiest thing used to be, I think, to break in would be like a 1,000-1,500 word provocative essay. And I always give my students the first assignment is write about your most humiliating secret. And many of them got in Salon. So do you think that writing a personal essay or maybe a really opinionated op-ed, writing the whole piece, might be a great way to start versus trying to pitch something longer?
If you're doing essays or something opinionated and timely, odds are that is so urgent and breaking off the news that you're going to have to send us the entire thing. By the time we have gotten to it and read it and gotten back to you, it could well be that, you know, if you're writing about last night's a convention, the story changed four times in the course of 4 hours. So a piece like that is moving pretty quickly. I think what Rob said is something I'd want to echo, is that every publication has a DNA to it, and the DNA is pretty apparent if you sort of look at it and try and decode it. And there are places that you can find a way in. There's a voice to understand. There's a kind of story that they take. There's a kind of story that they freelance. If you look at the masthead and sort of see what the staffers do and say, okay, you know, these 10 names are not staffers, so these are the freelance pieces that they're buying, and here's what they have in common, and this is the, you know, a place in the website or the publication where those stories are appearing. The secret in some ways to breaking in like that is to think like an editor. We have needs. We have to fill all of those spots, and, you know, something that is making our life easier is something that we are always looking for.
And you said that you think you might be taking freelance work at the Connecticut Mirror, or you don't know yet?
Yeah, I imagine we will be at some point.
And
soon.
I think,
you know, again, it becomes, you know, looking at something and sort of trying to figure out where the levers are to sneak in.
there's a Connecticut angle, right? Exactly. And I know Erin Keene was helping people at Salon. Is she a good person to send an essay to now that
sure,
you're
Erin's
not there?
Sure, Erin's terrific, absolutely.
Okay, good. Yeah, she was very helpful. Aspen, I know when you were writing your book, that aside from taking classes, I know you did writing workshops, and also you work with Jill Rothenberg, who's a great ghost editor. Could you talk about that a little bit? Like, did it help you to have a class or a writing group to bring pages to, and also to have somebody like Jill, who is a ghost editor, helping?
Yeah, so Jill was not a ghost editor for my book, but she helped me to write a proposal, because I really learned that it's a form. It's not like, it's not an impressionistic painting that you're making. You're following someone else's rules.
If you don't mind, could you mention the, so what's in a proposal, book proposal, nonfiction book proposal? So I know title, subtitle.
There are 8 parts, and I think I won't be able to list
okay,
them
let's
all,
see.
But, like, marketing
title,
analysis.
Subtitle, overview.
Yeah.
Sample chapters.
Mm-hmm. Book plan, publication, like, what was it? Promotion, marketing.
Yeah, so similar books.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
actually,
titles.
And actually, a smart thing that Aspen did also was that she had advanced blurbs, because when she did her Modern Love, Cheryl Strait and Nicholas Kristof, people liked her, the piece that she did, and so when they would say great things about it, tweeted or posted great things about it, she brilliantly would say, can I quote you on that?
Right, so every celebrity who had shared my Modern Love.
Lena Dunham, whoever liked her Modern Love, she said, can I quote you on that? So she actually was able to go to agents with advanced blurbs, which I think was really helpful.
Yeah.
Good, great. I heard that a lot of literary agents actually, like, you know, Aspen had published in Tin House and Salon and New York Times and Psychology Today, and I hear a lot of agents actually go to these, you know, they look for literary magazines and newspapers to find interesting pieces that might be books. So have you ever done that? Like, if you've read something short, do you ever contact the author?
Yeah, I do that quite regularly. And then, of course, it also helps me to know people like Rob and other editors who will very frequently, you know, sort of say, oh, you should, you know, look out for this voice. It's very, very promising, which goes back to what he said before. It's an industry of relationships. Yes, I'm constantly scouring journals and magazines for fresh voices, and I also encourage my colleagues to reach out. So we don't want to always wait and just be passive for that submission to come in. You know, we're anxiously looking for fresh new content.
Could I add?
Please.
I would love to add something to that, because I have a fun anecdote about a book that I discovered reading, I think it was The Atlantic magazine. I was home one day just reading this magazine, and I read this hilarious piece that Sandra Lowe Singh had written change in life and going through menopause, and I was laughing hysterically. I thought it was one of the best things I'd ever read. And so I said to myself, I bet this writer's on Facebook. And so I decided to Facebook her, and I sent her a private message on Facebook, and I said, I loved your essay. If you're interested in expanding this into a book, email me. And within 5 seconds, I got an email back from her. And then, funnily enough, she was going to be in New York. She lives in Los Angeles that week, and so we set up a meeting, and we talked, and we developed this idea for the book that is called The Mad Woman in the Volvo, and I highly recommend it, and it was a bestseller. So that just started from this kind of networking thing that we're talking about here.
Yeah, and actually, Aspen had, just from A Modern Love, I remember she had 7 different editors and agents contact you, right?
Yeah, yeah, and I heard from a lot of, like, people too, more like regular people who had similar experiences.
Right, and I think one of the first people who contacted her was HarperCollins, who wound up publishing your book.
Yeah, I remember I just wanted to, like, sign immediately with HarperCollins, and she was like, "Wait, you should probably get an agent and maybe like write some of it first."
great, and Danielle, have you ever seen work from somebody and then pursued them you know, a newspaper, magazine. Have any of your, have any of your books?
I have happened that way? A little bit in the past. More when I was doing more nonfiction, I would have to say, because I actually do a lot of commercial fiction and a little bit of commercial nonfiction. So for the type of fiction that I do, I'm probably not going to be scouring literary journals for it. But if I read something, I always can drop, you know, drop an editor a line or try to find out who represents them or something like that. But I think for nonfiction, when I was doing more of that, I would definitely read things and reach out to people. But since I do a great deal of commercial fiction now, I tend to do a lot of competitive reading, you know, reading other authors, you know, seeing what trends there might be in the types of books that I do. So I actually do a great deal of that.
I've also heard from editors, both fiction and nonfiction, who say that they love it when they know that an author can get out there and publish a piece in the New York Times or the New Yorker or Tin House, because it helps sell their book. And I remember when I did books with you that I love to do short pieces to promote the book. So is that like a plus to you? I've had editors who've said that it's especially wonderful when it's a fiction writer. Like, just for an example, Jennifer Weiner now is doing all these New York Times pieces, but it's especially great because it really does promote your book. So is that a good thing to learn, even if you are doing fiction?
Yeah, I think that's a good thing to learn. And I think something else you can do, I have an author now who's going to start maybe doing book reviews he's a fiction author, but he's starting to do some book reviews locally and then kind of expand from that just to get his name out there more and kind of have his byline on things. So I think that's a great way where they can each feed into each other.
Great, and I know, Rob, Tin House has launched a lot of books. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Because we're a filtering system, you know, because of the volume of submissions we get, every single issue that we publish that has people that don't have books in it yet, whoever they are, agents call me about them. Are they represented? Are they looking? Are they at a place where they can do? And so that's for mainly fiction, but also nonfiction, and a lot of essays that have appeared to sort of expanded and become books.
And was it hard for you to go from being really an editor for 18 years and a teacher to writing your own memoir? Was that a hard transition? I remember you.
Yes.
I remember you told me, I love, aside from that it took 10 years, you said at one point that both your wife and your mother hated your book.
Yeah, well, my wife hated my book right away because it was, well, when I gave her the first draft, she said, okay, you've done something here, that's interesting. But this Elisa, the wife, God, she's so boring, I just want to punch her in the face. So I'd been a little overly protective of her, and so she gave me permission to let it all out. But yeah, my job, the job I've created for myself is to promote other people and to put other people forward. And I run a literary festival out in Portland. I'm the membership director of Penn. I do all these other things, and I'm very comfortable promoting other people. So exposing myself was definitely a challenge, and that was part of the 10 years experience.
And did you say that when you showed your mother the book that she drove many hours?
No, she got on the train. She lives in Baltimore. She read the manuscript, got on a train in Baltimore, came up and sat at my kitchen table and spent 5 hours going over the manuscript, going, is this true? Did you really feel this way? So any bad review is nothing compared to my mom. I've survived the mom gauntlet. Yeah.
My mom too.
Yeah.
She came to my book party and was like, whispering into every person's ear, just so you know, Aspen has an incredible imagination.
Yeah.
The line that I say to my students is, the first piece you write that your family hates means that you found your voice. So that was great. So Corrina, I would love to talk about mistakes that people are making, that authors are making. And I know that a lot of editors, even though you have literary agents sometimes that are supposed to be vetting the manuscripts, I've heard a lot of book editors say that you get books that are half-baked, so that they're not quite ready, that people are rushing and they're not quite ready. Is that something that you see a lot, or can you think of other mistakes that you're seeing when you're rejecting manuscripts? What's the problem?
Well, I think, you know, part of it is I work with MFA students up at Columbia, and when a program is finished, a lot of them feel like they spent 2 years working really, really hard, and they want to come out and send their work out to agents and get something. kind of going, and I always tell them, you know, take the time that you need to actually get the manuscript in the best shape that you can possibly get it. And sometimes that's 5 months, sometimes it's a year, sometimes it's 5 years, which they don't want to hear, but it's the truth, and they'll remember it and feel comforted that someone said that. But it takes time, and there's no formula to it. I think one thing maybe on the editorial side is, in on any side, is taking the time once you get notes back to kind of digest the feedback that you're getting. You know, you may get a perspective back from an editor that isn't what you expected. Maybe you didn't expect anything back and that it would be perfect, which is kind of the hope that a lot of writers have, but there's always something. So to kind of read it, set it aside, go off, do your thing, and then come back to it maybe a day or two or three later and look at it with a new perspective. Because there are things, not everything will resonate with you, but there will be things that will make sense, and you'll know the way to answer it and to fix it.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that. So my first novel from start to finish took 13 years, so instead of a book launch, we gave it a book mitzvah. And everybody who helped me along the way came up to light a candle, so I like that. And I'm just going to share one of the tricks that a lot of people do but don't talk about, with which helped me, and actually two people told me the story, which was, so I was teaching and I was helping a lot of people get book deals, and I felt like the wedding planner who couldn't get married because it took me years and I was just having a lot of trouble getting a book deal together, and I was complaining to my shrink, and I was particularly complaining about two colleagues who just, one had a big nonfiction deal and one had a big memoir deal, a novel deal, and he said, well, take them out to lunch or dinner and see if you could pick their brain and see if you can get advice. So I went to lunch with my friend Larry and I said, you know, any advice you could give? And he said, okay, don't tell anyone, but the minute I finished my proposal, I hired this ghost editor named Sally, and she was awesome, and she kind of kicked it into shape. She's a former Doubleday editor, and here's her number. Don't tell anyone. I said, okay. So then I went to dinner with Yona and I said, how'd you get the novel deal? And she said, okay, just between us, there's this really great ghost editor named Sally who I use, and she gave me the number. But when I called Sally, I had a 220-page manuscript that I hadn't been able to sell, and when I called Sally, it would have been $2,200 was what she estimated. So I went to my shrink and I said, that's insane. The whole reason I'm writing a book is to make money. I can't afford it. And he's like, are you fucking crazy? Two people just gave you the same number and you've wasted years trying to get published, and you know, sometimes you have to spend money to make money. So I literally like put it on credit cards and went into debt and spent $2,200, and my first advance was $50,000, and it had seven foreign rights, a film deal, a TV deal, and 9 other books. So now I swear by ghost editors, even though, and it turns out there's a lot of people in the business that actually use them but don't talk about them, but I like to talk about them because I always feel like if you're, especially a student or somebody young, if you're sitting in your apartment or you know, your parents' basement and you finish a manuscript and you've never written a book before, it's not ready to go to an agent. It just isn't. And if you can't afford an MFA program or classes or a great writing workshop, there is other ways you could do it. And if you could afford it, you could hire a top editor to help you, to kick it back and forth and to find out what's wrong with it and critique it. And one of my favorite ghost editors is here, actually Angie Chen, who was at FSG, and she specializes in young adult, and she's really been helping me with a middle grade book. And I think young adult or kids books are especially complicated because there's so many different genres and every age group is different, whatever. Anyway, so if anybody wants to get recommendations for great ghost editors I work with, feel free, but that's one of my tricks. Jill, could you talk a little bit about what mistakes are you seeing, especially with a poetry manuscript? Because I feel like I know so many poets that just have this really unrealistic view. Just for an example, I always get a lot of people that say to me, oh, can I use your agent for my poetry collection? And they just have this fantasy that they're going to get like a $50,000 advance for poetry. And I try to explain that, you know, that I think the most I ever got paid for a poem was $250. So could you talk a little bit about mistakes that people make?
Yeah, but before I do that, I want to add to the conversation that you just mentioned. You said that you had a bat mitzvah for your book. Well, I had a funeral for my first novel. And all to say that that it took me about 10 years to figure out how to write a novel. And I had been working on so many different drafts and submitting it at certain stages in that process through an agent. And I would get these really wonderful letters back saying, you know, that the editors love the writing or the love the characters, but that there was a problem with the story and with the plot. And I finally had to literally bury the novel because I was just, I couldn't see my way through the, what is the expression, the forest through the trees, or the trees through the forest. And then one day I happened to be in a conversation with a writer, and I shared this dilemma. I was publishing poetry at the time, and I just, still this novel was perplexing me, and I really wanted to try to resurrect it again. And he offered to read it for me, and he gave me just the advice that I had been needed to hear, which was that a novel cannot move forward one event after another, as in normal time, that you have to have a dramatic event that then triggers the whole denouement. In any event, just hearing something like that, and he also talked about the fact that I violated point of view, and so I decided to shift the point of view into first person, and I had a great idea for this dramatic moment, and then the book wrote itself. And I offer that comment only because it's such a mysterious process. You work on something for so long and so many drafts, and you just can't see it anymore. And sometimes putting it away is actually the thing to do. And maybe I got lucky. But back to poetry. You know, poetry is its own little network. It really doesn't operate the way that that other kinds of genres operate in terms of publication. And I think it's because there are very, the audience for poetry is very limited, and the poets that really are committed to it, I find, go for the long haul and figure it out. I really believe that they publish their poetry in literary magazines, they go to conferences, they network, and they're in it because they need to be in it. And that's kind of how it happens. And there are so many presses now that are publishing books of poetry that, you know, years ago it used to be five houses like Norton, Knopf, FSG, Houghton Mifflin maybe. Now I don't even know how many presses are publishing poetry. So I think there's a lot of options, and that could be, we could discuss this for hours.
Yeah, I love what you said about getting criticism, and it reminds me, in my process for trying to publish my novel, I had this really tough critic friend from Michigan, a mentor, and I remember showing it to her. It was a novel about two sister-in-laws that switch lives, so I showed it to her, and I said, okay, what's wrong? Why aren't people publishing it? And I remember she said to me, number one, you have no imagination whatsoever. Stop writing fiction. She said, number two, it's about two sister-in-laws, which is really boring. Write about sex. And she said, you're ambivalent about the person in the book. You write better about people you love. And so I said, should I rewrite it? She's like, put it away. And I went home crying, thinking she was an idiot. And then I was reading, I remember I had been reading Nick Hornby's High Fidelity, and he had a little section about going back to re-meet his top five heartbreaks of all time. And I remember thinking, oh, if the guy does it, he looks at her and said, oh, she's still hot, I'll still sleep with her and it's over. I thought if the woman did it, there'd be like 20,000 pages of journal entries and therapy sessions and the gum wrapper from the first date. So I changed courses, and I did a book about a woman who goes back to re-meet her top five heartbreak of all time, which was the book that Danielle bought, Five Men Who Broke My Heart. And it wasn't until 10 years later that I figured out how to do a novel. So I actually agree, and I think that getting criticism, finding really smart criticism, I think was really, really helpful for me. So Dave, could you tell us about the kind of mistakes that you were seeing at Salon? Because I know a lot of my students were sending work to Salon, and you hit upon something that I think the people that were successful quite often found a timely angle for a piece. So just for an example, a student of mine recently wrote a piece about how her first date was when she was in a juvenile detention home, and she wasn't sure how to sell it, and then all of a sudden when she called it Orange Was Not the New Black, it ran the first day in Salon. It was a very splashy big hit in Salon, and it ran the day that the Netflix put out the new season. So would you say maybe that some of the mistakes are people are sending you what we call evergreens, and that if you could ever find something timely, that that might help?
There is nothing better than a news hook or a culture hook or something that gives us a headline or a way in or an urgency to why we ought to publish that right now. I mean, absolutely. I mean, and I think it just gets back to understanding the voice and the DNA of every publication and the kinds of things that they like. I mean, if you read Salon or if you read any place else, you begin to understand, well, they publish personal essays 5 days a week at this time, and if I miss those times, they give them this tag so I can go back and I can look and I can see what they all are, and sort of this is what's common about them. And what we would often find, I mean, we were really interested in being sure that all of these pieces were read and that they found their maximum audience, which is good for us and it's good for the writer. And being sure that you have a compelling hook is not only a good way to get the story read, it's a good way to make the editor kind of stand up and say, oh yeah, this, because I'm looking for an Orange Is the New Black story tonight.
And I always say to my students, write about your obsessions. And I think you were obsessed with the story and the electoral process when you were doing your own book. And can you talk about that a little bit? Because I feel like, I think you said that this book actually wrote itself pretty quickly, right?
It did. Astonishingly quickly. Jill's an editor at the house, so Jill knows how quickly it was written. I mean, that book came about because I fundamentally didn't understand how the Democrats could have as big a win as they did in 2012, how Barack Obama could win the White House as big as he did, how 25 of 33 Democrats could get reelected to the Senate that year, but that the House didn't budge one bit. And it was just really that question that sort of set, you know, what happened that set me off to finding out about this really fascinating Republican electoral strategy in 2010 to go state legislature by state legislature and to flip as many chambers as they could so that the next year in the every 10-year redistricting, they would have every seat at the table, and in all of these blue and purple states, they would have every seat at the table and just draw the Democrats out in such a way that they would control the congressional delegations. And the more you research it, the angrier you get and the more you find, and it was all sort of right there for the telling, and it was all sort of in plain sight if you looked in the right place and asked the right question.
Great. And Aspen, I remember when we were talking about writing about your obsessions and what was going on, at first when you started writing your essay, I remember you were a little bit apprehensive to write about getting raped in college. And then could you talk about, in a way, how writing about it was healing and all the women that contacted you?
Yeah, so my first draft of my modern love essay was basically the story of walking from Mexico to Canada through California and Oregon and Washington State, and meeting on that walk the man who would become my husband, who was also walking from Mexico to Canada. And I submitted it to Sue, and she said, but like, why did you do it? Like, why did you want to walk from Mexico to Canada? And I was like, I really would rather not talk about that, I'll tell you, but I told her that on my second day of my freshman year of college, like before classes had even started, I was raped, and I dropped out and I left, and I decided I wanted to try to physically, literally reclaim my body and find a way to feel safe again in the world that I had to keep living in the body that I had to keep living in. And she was like, well, I think your essay should begin with your rape. And I was like, no. But eventually, I did. And I think that's probably why so many people have responded to it, because I'm honest and because I'm disclosing something that I was ashamed about, and many people are ashamed about. And as they say, like, silence has the rusty taste of shame. And when I told the truth, it made it something outside of me. Like, I was no longer the terrible, horrible, disgusting thing the rape was. And to call a spade kind of like shrinks it. It makes it something separate from you. And it was ultimately very healing. And then I heard from many, many people who had been through similar things.
And if I remember, didn't Lena Dunham say that your piece inspired her to write about something that happened to her in college that she wrote about in her book?
Yeah, so Lena wrote to me and told me, years after we'd already known each other, but she told me that the reason she decided to write about her college date rape was because of my modern love.
And didn't you donate part of the proceeds of your book to Rain?
Yeah, I'm donating 5% of my proceeds to the Rape, Abuse, and Incest Social Network.
And you're a spokesperson for them?
I am, yeah.
So you would recommend if there's maybe something hard to write about sometimes, that's a good thing to be able to try?
Yeah, like, you're never the only one, even though you feel that way. And when you write about something, you'll find your people and they'll find you.
Good. And Ayesha, could you talk a little bit about the mistakes that people are making when they're contacting literary agents? Because, like, the one that I see all the time is that somebody, you know, writes a piece and it's like, okay, now I'm ready to go to a literary agent. I'm like, wait a second, it's 900 words. Like, you know, if they contact you, that's one thing. But even if they contact you, you should probably not say, oh yeah, I have these 700 pages I've been kicking around that are really rough. Here, I'm emailing it to you. So is that one of the mistakes people are making? Are they in a little bit too much of a hurry and they're giving you projects that aren't ready yet?
I think that's one of the most common mistakes that they're making, even though I would say that sometimes there's a justification for getting in touch with a literary agent quickly or for making that connection quickly. I'm thinking of my client Christine Lee, who wrote a BuzzFeed essay called I Had a Stroke at the Age of 33, and it just went viral. And even though it's an entirely different story from your story, I think what the two have in common is that it's about a person who overcame an extremely difficult and challenging experience in her life and how it transformed her, but ultimately, you know, how she found her way back to herself. And it was, you know, extraordinarily moving. And a lot of editors contacted her. So I made a connection with her and we worked together on the proposal, and then we sold it to Echo at HarperCollins. So those kinds of stories are, you know, so it's there's not always one particular rule, but I would say that in general, take it as far as you possibly can on your own, with, of course, you know, help of workshops and other, you know, your community of writers and teachers and things like that. But I think the biggest mistake is to think that you're ready too early. I mean, writing is a craft and it takes time. It takes time to master.
And are there, aside from, as I said, I used a ghost editor, and aside from classes and panels like this, is there anything else you could, any other advice you could give to help people to improve their work?
Well, I mean, like, some writers tell me that, oh, well, I'm writing a novel and you're talking about, you know, publishing short stories, but that's not my form. And I mean, they do have a point, but there's things that you can do with a novel too. You can get residencies, you can get fellowships, you know, you can go to Tin House and workshop your novel in the amazing summer workshop that seems to be transformative and really life-changing. Or you can just have an informal group of writers. Whatever you choose to do, you need to sort of show evidence to editors and agents that you've practiced your craft, you've taken it seriously, and you've really put in the hours, the sweat equity.
Great. Danielle, what kind of mistakes are you seeing both with fiction and nonfiction when you're getting the manuscripts?
I would say one of the things that everyone else has spoken to, too, is sort of doing your due diligence in whatever it is that you're writing about, whether it is fiction or nonfiction. If it's nonfiction, as Aspen was saying, there are different sections in a proposal for the nonfiction, and if the one section is competitive or, you know, the market analysis, that you either compare your book to the best-selling book X that yours has a sliding resemblance to, or not really doing the research, and now everyone with Amazon and all online retailers can easily do research to find out other books that might be similar to your book or might have a similar theme, to really do the research and the work, because someone else is going to do that research and work, so make sure that you have and that you're putting very accurate material in your proposal. And for fiction, I would say, I think reading widely is really important. I mean, for fiction and nonfiction, I mean, that's one of the main things I tell people who want to be writers or who are writers, is to don't forget to read. You know, don't forget to, you know, you can be very focused on your own writing and what you're doing, but to make sure that you're reading widely in the areas that you're interested in, so you can see what other people are writing and doing, so that you don't come up with, you might come up with something that you think is a great idea, but, oh, somebody kind of just did something with a very similar plot twist that got a huge amount of attention 6 months ago, so yours might not seem as fresh. So to read and really keep up with what's out there, don't do it in too much of a bubble.
Yeah, every term I have someone that comes to me, a student, and they wanted to write a book. I want to write a book about how I quit drinking. And I'm like, you know, that's a great subject, but, you know, there are 10,000 books already on it, which doesn't mean you can't do it. It's just, is there anything different about what you're writing? And actually, I remember when I was, I did a book with Danielle, Lighting Up, which was, it was Lighting Up, How I Quit Smoking, Drinking, and Everything I Loved in Life Except Sex. And I remember I took her advice, and my agent also said, the minute you have an idea for a book, look it up and see what's out there. And so I was writing an addiction book, and when I went to look up and go to bookstores and Amazon and find out, you know, just to see what was already out there, I found out that there were millions of books about getting off of alcohol, getting off of cocaine, getting off of crack, getting off of pills. There, at the time, there had been not one funny memoir, not one real memoir about quitting cigarettes, which was my main addiction. So I actually focused the book on that. And so in my proposal, I mentioned the market analysis. I mentioned some of the best-selling books about addiction, but said, and here's a hole. There's never been one about, even though 22% of people in this country still smoke, there's never been one on that. So that was way in. And also, one thing Danielle reminded me is there's always somebody who compares their book to Great Gatsby. So you always want to be careful. And actually, a lot of nonfiction, a lot of memoirs, Eat, Pray, Love. So those are, you don't want to pick like a huge bestseller. The best pitch I heard was a student of mine said her book was an anti-Eat, Pray, Love, where she went all over the world and she didn't get laid, she didn't get a husband, she didn't get a book deal, everything screwed up, no enlightenment whatsoever. And I thought, okay, well, that at least is a twist. Anyway, Rob, we're talking about mistakes. So what were you doing wrong for 10, like, why did it take you 10 years to write a memoir? You're helping all these people get published and get these huge book deals. What do you think it was that took 10 years?
Well, you would think as an editor I would know how to do it, but I was doing it. I spent 7 years sort of excavating the material and trying to find the form that worked. And you know, one of the pivotal sort of texts for me reading was The Situation in the Story, Vivian Gornick's book, because I see this a lot with Tin House too. I see people mistaking their situation, which is whatever, you know, alcoholism, you know, being addicted to cigarettes. But what is the actual story? You know, and a concrete example of that is War and Peace. Why do you read War and Peace? To find out if Napoleon takes Moscow? Spoiler alert, he does, but it doesn't work out too well. Now, you read it about because of the three families and their, you know, long, twisted story about life under occupation under the French and life under wartime. So, like, trying to figure out what is the actual story of my material, because I have pretty crazy material, So trying to unearth that and also trying to find the form that would contain it. And it wasn't until I found the braided form that I was able to, as Jill said, the book kind of wrote itself after that. But even after that, there was another 3 years, and then there was a hell of a lot of editing, as someone at this table can attest to, that there are many revisions after it sold as well.
So. Great, okay, I'll ask one more question, then we're going to open it up. So what are you excited about now? So Corrina, what are you working on, or was there anything in particular that was interesting about working on All Tomorrow's Parties with Rob?
Oh, everything was interesting about that. Yeah. No, that was like a dream scenario. And one of the great things is when you get to work with a writer who kind of reimagines your notes in a totally unexpected way. So, you know, if I had, you know, sometimes most of the time I don't know how to fix something. I just know when something isn't quite working and I can't put my finger on it sometimes. And, you know, I might say something unhelpful, like, this isn't working, I don't know what to do. And then the writer, and Rob did this too, would just go off and reimagine it in a completely beautiful, unexpected way that solved it and totally just made the whole thing come together. So that's part of the magic of working on something with a writer that kind of can take things not in a very literal way, but to figure things out that way. So, yeah.
And are there any other books that you're working on now that you're excited about that are coming out?
Yeah, there is a reimagining of the Lizzie Borden story that we're publishing next summer that is just as creepy as you would imagine, but totally steps outside the Borden mold, where you just feel like you're reading a dysfunctional family story, very dysfunctional. But it's chilling and great.
Great. And
who's the writer?
Sarah Schmidt, and it's called See What I Have Done.
Great, and so Jill, what's exciting for you? And I know that your book, The Prize, got rave reviews. It's a compelling odyssey of a man unhinged by his ideals, an unflinching portrait of a marriage struggling against the treacherous fault line between art and money. Is that wildly exciting for you, having published so many other authors, to be getting great reviews for your own book?
Of course, yes. But I'll tell you what I'm excited about that has just come out that I've edited. And because I do the three genres, poetry, fiction, and nonfiction, I'll give one for each, sort of like trying to pick your favorite child. But so we have the new Audrian Rich Collected, which just came out, and I urge everyone to read that. So important. So of the moment. And in nonfiction, we just published Mary Roach and her new book Grunt, about the science of war. And in fiction, I just edited a novel called The Unseen World by Liz Moore, and today is the official pub date, so I urge you to check those books out.
Fantastic. And Dave, again, you helped so many people for so many years, so when you saw Ratf, the true story behind the secret plan to steal America's democracy, was that like, was the biggest thrill when the book came, or was it when they said yes?
Yeah, it still feels like a bit of a fever dream. So it is still strange to look down and really see it.
And did you fight for the title? Because I know they have two stars instead of, did you really want you wanted that fucked in there, even though it was going to be hard to get the whole name in the New York Times?
We sold this book as Gerrymandered Nation.
Oh, hilarious. At what point did you tell the editor the title's changing?
And it evolved into Rat Fucked, because Gerrymandered Nation put us all to sleep. Nobody would be talking about this. And it doesn't capture the full outrage of what has happened to, you know. I mean, gerrymandering is the kind of thing that put us all to sleep in seventh grade civics class. I see three of you falling asleep right now. Wake up! The idea of this is that it's actually a really exciting story about the political sabotage and manipulation of the essence of our democracy. Needed a title that would grab you by the throat.
What's the high point so far? Was it seeing that huge New Yorker piece?
That was pretty cool. Fresh air was a lot of fun. Yeah, it's all been fun.
Great.
It's been a blast.
So Aspen, what was the most exciting part? I know you were exhausted after a couple years of finishing your book. What was the most exciting part so far? Was it seeing the book or being finished?
Being done.
It was hard for you to write, right?
Yeah, I'd say selling film rights was really exciting.
bad.
Great. And Ayesha, what are you excited about now? Is there anything coming out that you from your agency?
There's the memoir by Christine Lee that I mentioned that's coming out from Echo. There's also a book that I'm passionately in love with that won the Penn Bellwether Prize called The Leavers by Lisa Koh, about an undocumented Chinese immigrant who is separated from her son in the most dramatic and heart-wrenching of ways. And that's being published by Algonquin.
Danielle, what are you excited about now?
I also first wanted to make the point, since I'm an editor, that I actually don't write. That not every book editor secretly wants to be a writer, but has failed and then became an editor, just to let you know.
But she's married to a comedy writer.
Right, so I get to critique his stuff, which is fun. But I think, you know, editing is kind of its own skill, so totally apart from writing, even though I write promotional material and such. But in terms of stuff coming up, I actually have a book that's coming up next week that we're publishing in August, and it's called Watching Edie by Camilla Way, and it's a debut novel. It's a debut literary thriller, kind of psychological suspense about two women who were friends when they were in high school and then never spoke again for 15 years, and one is now re-upped and has reappeared in the other one's life, so not quite knowing what's going on and why the other woman is now back in her early 30s, and sort of a little bit of an update on sort of single white female and obsession and betrayal, and it's really compelling, and she's a terrific writer, and it was just picked as the number 3 library reads pick for August, so I'm excited about that.
So Rob, what was the most exciting thing? I think you did 100 events for all around the world for Altamar's parties. What was the most exciting part of it?
I think holding the finished thing, you know, was the most exciting thing. The actual, you know, then it seemed real. Up until then, it didn't seem real.
And do you have more events coming up?
Yeah, I'm doing a bunch of festivals. I'm going to like Decatur Festival and Wordstock and things like that. I just wanted to add something about that we've all been touching on, that publishing really is an ecosystem, and that you get what you put into it out. You know, so really read widely, and you know, read out of your comfort zone. And you know, that's another reason why it took me so long. I know it's possible, and I wanted to push myself. And so, you know, the things that I'm excited about are, yes, you know, I just published Joy Williams' 99 Stories of God, her new story collection. It's gonna be in the New Yorker next week. James Wood is writing this big piece about it, Times Book Review. But I'm also equally excited when I discover something like Brian Blanchfield's book, The Proxies. It's called Proxies. And it's from Night Boat Press, amazing collection of short essays about his obsessions. So, you know, I'm still, that's why we're all readers, is to be excited, and, you know, it doesn't matter if it's a Tin House book.
One of my favorite lines about publishing is people think it's a business, but it's really a casino, because they never know. And my biggest thrill was, so What's Never Said was a novel I spent 6 years on, and I actually dedicated the book to Danielle Perez and to my editor for this book, my heliotrope editor, Naomi Rosenblatt, who's here. And so I have, for some reason, having two female Greenwich Village editors just feels like some amazing dream. And the other thing was, Aspen surprised me, and she dedicated her book to me. So that never happened before. She said, my parents hate it, so.
I didn't say that.
I'm kidding.
What are you talking about?
They did. Anyway, so now let's open it up for questions. So yes, Alex Miller.
All right, thanks for coming, appreciate it. Congratulations, Rob.
Thank you.
I keep your book in my backpack because I love Germany, and I might go on a nostalgia emergency, so I keep it in my backpack. This question is for Rob and Dave. My question is, you know, with all the social injustice and all the politics that's going on right now, do you feel that there are pieces submitted to you guys that can be overly angry or overly punished because people are mad as rat fuck.
Yeah, and Alex, he's working on a piece about being an African-American vet and how used to be when he would say he was a vet, that was his get-out-of-jail-free card, and now all of a sudden people are vilifying black vets because of the two recent shootings of police. So he's writing about it, and I read it, and I thought a couple pieces were great, but he was submitting an op-ed. So I said, I don't know if an op-ed could start out enraged and end up enraged. Like, I'm not sure, although let's ask, because Dave is a perfect person because he writes about political stuff. In fact, you've actually, you do a lot of short political pieces for Salon, I saw.
I think tone and voice and the kind of publication you're aiming for matter a lot. Are you going to get that a piece on the Times op-ed page? Probably not. Could you put it in Salon? Probably. I mean, if you, so it becomes a question of, you know, again, of kind of thinking smart about the kind of publication you're submitting to, the kind of work they publish, the range of voice and perspective that they not only publish, but that they allow their writers to take. And, you know, and then understanding that you also want to get the largest number of readers that you can. So, you know, a really angry piece that is published someplace nobody sees it may not have much of an impact. If you can adjust the voice and tone to meet the needs of a publication, and this is always a two-way street, then you know, it's that balance of pure voice and desire to have that voice be heard by the largest number of people, and where you can balance that out, I think it always matters.
Good, Rob.
Yeah, that's a tough question, because I think we're always looking for real pure voices. So my tendency is, and me personally, one of my sort of publishing heroes is William Gass, who said, "Why do you write?" He said, "I hate a lot, hard." You know, rage was a driver for him. And I think a couple of the most important books of the last 2 years are Ta-Nehisi Coates's book and Claudia Rankine's book, and they are both filled with righteous anger and justified righteous anger. And, you know, Casey Lehman right now is getting like a lot of traction for his righteous rage. I brought him to my festival last week, and he had the opening lecture, and he said, "You've invited me to this place of privilege, and I'm uncomfortable with that, and I want to burn it down. Let's talk about it." So, you know, I mean, there is reception for rage, and I think if you get into some place smaller with your true voice, other people will see it.
And tinhouse.com sometimes will take essays,
yeah,
timely
absolutely.
Essays, right? Because if you were to try the regular Tin House, they have a long lead time, but I think you can get up a piece faster.
Also look for, when you're looking at more literary places, they have theme issues coming up. Look at their guidelines to see what places like Tin House are working on. So you might have something, like for instance, my spring next year issue is called Rehab, and it's about all kinds of rehab, like rehabilitating image, rehabilitating the image of people, places, things, you know. So that would be actually a decent fit for that.
Great. Other questions? Yes, in the back.
I'm looking for advice about publishing children's books. Now, you know, the illustrations aren't done yet, but they're completed. Any kind of advice you have for...
Okay, I'm going to introduce you to Angie Chen. Are you still here, Angie? Yeah, Angie Chen works at... she worked for a couple years at FSG, the kids department, and she was fantastic. She works with a former student of mine, Joy Peskin, and my guess is the first thing you would have to figure out is exactly which... area, because isn't there, what is there, picture books, young readers? Yeah, here, you'll take Angie's card. And also, if you're interested, here we can pass out her card. And if you're interested, the new school actually has classes in children's books. And I would say to me, and I don't know if you guys can add anything, but the thing that fascinated me was how many divisions they are and how specific they are. For example, I'm working on a book right now, middle grade memoir, age 10 to 12. And so I didn't even realize that it's based on grade. And also one of my, I had a student that wrote a children's book and handed it in, or went to a ghost editor like Angie, and it was 74 pages or something, and then she just laughed. She's like, we do 1,000 words, you know, so you have to be really specific. I have another student, Renee Watson, who has written, look her up, she from the new school, she has written several picture books, and she actually, she started this new nonprofit in Harlem to help young artists and writers. So if you email me, I'll give you her email address. But so I would say the minute you have an idea, I would say do research before you spend too much time on it to make sure that you're, you know, just that you even know the word length or the age of the kid. Great. Other questions? Yes, in the back.
So I was just wondering about rejection. If you get rejected by an agent or an agent, how many times do you get rejected without being rejected? So, like, if you get a first line response, and you submit it again, can you mention that you got a first line rejection?
And are you talking for books or for newspaper, magazine,
or
for
magazine?
Everything? For anything. Okay, so she's asking if you get rejected, and actually, Rob, you were really funny with my class about how, first he had a funny thing about how if men get rejected.
All right, so, so with personal notes, take them really seriously, because you have to imagine that someone like me, on my reading day, I have a stack of 100 manuscripts that I'm dying to get through, and you know, I'm just trying to get weed them through. And by writing you an encouraging note, I don't do that as a favor. I mean, I have so much work. It's an invitation to send more. And when the Vita numbers first came out, I really looked at our own numbers. If you don't know Vita, it's vita.org, it's Women in Literary Arts, and that tracks submission numbers and also publication numbers. So men are 4 times more likely to resubmit after a friendly letter than women. So 100% basically.
It's did like you say that, like if you say to a guy no, he'll say, oh, how about this?
Yeah, even if I reject flat out, I never want to see you again. You're horrible, you're bugging me. It's like, oh, how about this though? So women are 4 times less likely to resubmit. And for a literary magazine, you know, don't like 10 seconds later say send something unless I say what else do you have. If I say keep me in mind the future, that means the future. You know, I mean, the analogy I use is dating. Like you've been on an okay date and you're going home and you're walking up the stairs and the phone's ringing. It's like, hey, how about tomorrow? And it was like an okay date. You know, it wasn't a great date. But it's much sexier to an editor like 2 months down the line say, I've just, you know, I've finally finished something that I think is right for you. Thanks so much for your letter of, you know, whatever. And it can be, there's no statute of limitations. People feel that red hot urge to, like, I must jump on this now. You could wait 5 years. You can say, thanks so much for your letter of, you know, 2006. I joined a Japanese death cult, lived in a cave for 10 years, somehow survived, and I've got this story. I'm like, oh, cool. That's great. You know, we're still in the hamster wheel of publishing. You know?
But by the way, I would recommend a lot of my students say, they'll start a letter for after they've been rejected, and they'll say, you didn't like my other piece, and you said that it wasn't right for you, you know, 7 months ago, and then they'll say the name of the piece, and they'll just go on and on about it. I just say, thanks so much for your kind response last time. And then just submit something else. And Ayesha, if you say no to a manuscript, how long should somebody wait if they want to? Usually you don't want to revise the thing that they said no to, but if somebody wanted to submit a different project to you, is that okay? Or should they wait? Or should they wait until you say, send me something else?
I probably wouldn't want them to resubmit the same project unless I specifically request it. In terms of other projects, yeah, I mean, I think it depends on the note of my initial rejection. If it was a personalized rejection in which I gave some very positive feedback and said, you know, this is promising, blah, 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 then I think absolutely the door is open.
Can I add a few other don'ts? Don't pull your piece and send a new version.
No.
I get that all the time, or more often than I like, you know. It's like it's in the system, there are multiple people reading it, and then someone says, actually don't read that, I like jump the gun, and you know. It's just anything you can do to not piss us off would be really, really, really good. Don't ask why I rejected something. You know, if I send you an encouraging note, it's like, could you clarify why this didn't work for you? It's like, no, I can't, actually. I'm completely overwhelmed. It's just, you know, it's just more work.
I'll say that I had 14 rejections on a piece that I wound up publishing in the New York Times and wound up landing a book. So just because you get rejections doesn't mean anything. I had one book that had 30 rejections from agents and 30 rejections from editors that then became a big hit. I will say that after I get especially a few rejections, I will then look at the piece again, maybe bring it into my writing group or hire a ghost editor like Angie, and I'll say, tell me what's wrong with this. And I would say if there's people in your life that just think everything you do is brilliant and read it and say, great, find a real critic who has published what you want, because sometimes what happens is I'll write a piece and it gets rejected a few times, and then I'll completely rewrite it and rethink it, and then it gets published. Good. A few more questions? Yes, John.
For Ayesha, is it a disadvantage for a writer to write a lot of different types of things, short stories, thrillers, fantasy? Is that a disadvantage, or you just want to see one type of thing?
Are you saying a writer who's published all of those things or is trying to publish all of those things?
Trying to publish.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, by the way, don't say in your letter, like a lot of people make the mistake and they'll say, I have written 4 novels and, you know, 17 short stories and 12 poems, and if they're not published, don't even mention that.
Yeah,
you know, like only mention the information that's going to help you. Like just for an example, you have a really beautiful parenting piece on being a dad. So if I were you when you're sending that piece out, I think we talked about the New York Times or Washington Post, all I would do is say, you know, I'm a father of 2 daughters. You know, because that information, that's just really helpful information. And anything you've written that's not published, I wouldn't mention yet. You know, if they come back and ask you questions, then answer. But I only give the info that's going to help.
I mean, that's what I mean. I don't mean that it, in and of itself it's a bad thing to try your hand as a writer at different forms. In fact, I think that can be very good practice. But I'm talking about if you are submitting or querying, then you shouldn't necessarily mention that you have all of these different projects. You should just query for the one particular thing and then give, you know, compelling evidence that you are good at writing that particular form.
Great. Other questions? Yes, Elizabeth.
A timeline for submitting a nonfiction book proposal. Is it, do you write the book proposal first, then query an agent, or I had a publisher contact me based on pieces I have written?
I think if somebody contacts you, that's a little bit different than you going out. Because if somebody contacts you, that means they're already interested and that I would rush it. But if it's about you're just sitting home writing a proposal, I personally would not only write the whole thing, what I would do is I would hire a ghost editor, kick it into shape, make sure it's great. And then what I would do is I would probably try to sell a short piece like Aspen did. I would try to sell a short piece to the New York Times or Salon or Tin House so that by the time I'm going to agents, I could say, oh, here's a link. Did you see my recent piece? But Ayesha, you would be a better person in terms of agents.
So you're saying that publishers have contacted you for your small, for short pieces?
Was it based on a short piece that you did?
Yes.
Then I would, you know, I would say I'm working on a proposal and I'll be back to you as soon as I have the proposal finished and then work on that proposal with an agent and do a really, really, really good job.
Finish the proposal, then find an agent, then go back to
your publishers. That's
well,
what I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also if you want, I could recommend ghost editors to help you kick it into shape faster. And by the way, if you write to agents and you say, oh, this Doubleday editor contacted me or this Grove Atlantic editor contacted me because they were interested, that's a really fast way to get an agent.
Yeah, I match make all the time because I have, you know, either a publisher contact me, you know, asking, and then they don't have an agent. And so I'll take them out and, like, really take your, no one's going anywhere. You don't have to leap on it, you know. Just having that that interest, you know, will you know, get you far.
I mean, that said, I've had a couple of authors contact me who were in your position who just said, look, I've gotten a lot of interest from publishers, and do you see a book here? And if, you know, would you be willing to help me work on the proposal? And if I thought that it was both timely and big enough or saleable enough, then I would definitely be open to doing that. So yeah.
Great. Any final questions? Last question.
Let's say this is short stories. You submitted what you think is, like, it's your favorite story to press for. You submit it. It's sitting at the top tier places, like, maybe months, and you followed up, and it's a contention. And in the meantime, you got to really be published. And in the meantime, you got to be published in 1 month. Would you follow up and see?
Sure. What do you think?
Or is that a mistake?
No, it's not a mistake. It's not a mistake, especially. Yeah. No. Also, like, you know, the guidelines say we're supposed to get back to you within 3 months. So after 3 months, like, a polite query is really totally in bounds, and say, oh, and by the way, some other stories have won this and this and that. Just not to, it's how your tone, you know. If you're like, where the bleep is my bleeping story, you know, then I'll be like, oh, great, you know. But a polite query that's within the bounds of the guidelines is totally, totally
and
acceptable.
Actually, most newspaper magazine editors that I know say don't multiple submit. You can only submit to one place and wait. Rob is one of the few people that says because he takes so long, you can absolutely multiple submit, so that if you're waiting too long, send it somewhere else. Send it to New York, or send it to The Atlantic, send it to Paris Review. But then the minute that you hear a yes, you get right in touch with them and say, okay,
yeah,
aim high,
but multiply submit. I mean, anybody who holds that against you, I have no patience for, just because it's so hard, it's so competitive, and it's my fault for not getting to it faster. You know, that's all. I've had cases where I've been, like, about to buy something and someone contacts me and said, it's been taken somewhere else, and my reaction is always, crap, I wasn't fast enough, send me your next thing. You know, it's my fault for not getting there faster. And then I'd also advise you to, like, you know, you have to realize that I reject things all the time that are really, really, really good, that I see in Best American Stories every year, that just aren't my cup of tea. You know, I mean, just being in the right place at the right time is also part of it.
Great. Well, I want to thank the Strand Bookstore. I want to thank these fantastic panelists who came out tonight. And I especially want you guys, everybody's going to stay here and sign their books. So Jill Bialosky, the prize, her acclaimed novel just recently came out. We have Dave Daley's first book, Ratf, we're selling. Aspen Matis' debut, Girl in the Woods. And the man of the hour, all tomorrow's parties, Rob Spillman. So thank you guys so much for coming. Buy books. We'll hang out and sign them. Thank you. And we're going to sign books. So come meet everybody really quickly.